So I'm back in Bath again with Parkinson's specialist Dr. Robin Fackrell. And this time we're doing a Q&A session. So I've had a number of questions from people around the country and around the world, actually. I'm newly diagnosed. When should I start taking medication for Parkinson's?
Yeah, so that's a good question. When you first start to develop symptoms, that's when you've noticed a problem. So you've noticed a disability. We want to put that right. And so if there's a dopamine depletion, we need to correct it. And the evidence really is that the sooner we start treating, the better the long-term outcome. And there's reasons for that. Because if we can get you moving better and feeling better, then you're more likely to stay active and your physical health is improved, cardiovascular health is improved. And that means that we don't allow things to deteriorate further before we act. Because therein lies problems, because you become less active, and more likely to fall and do all those kinds of things. So I think it's really important, if there is a problem that you've seen a doctor about, we should be doing something about it early.
I would agree from that. From a patient perspective, I've observed people who, you know, quite rightly are reluctant to start on medication. They're worried about the long-term side effects and things like that. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a mistake. For me personally, it made a huge difference to my life. Just getting medicated has enabled me to be very active over the last 8 years.
I don't think people should to limit their medications in order for a probably not well-founded view that the future might be challenging, because I'm not sure that's true.
When is the optimal time to take Parkinson's medication in relation to food? Should you take it before eating, after eating, with food?
Excellent question. Often people can get a bit obsessed about this, and it can really cause them great concern and anxiety. The pharmacists, and I respect all my pharmacy colleagues hugely, give advice about taking it before food, after food, etc. And that typically, I think, is because that's how the clinical trials were done, in very austere circumstances, to get the very best possible result. But if you translate that to a 4 or 5 times a day medication regime, trying to negotiate meal times means that people then get really worried about doing things right. The actual evidence is that most people, particularly early on in their Parkinson's journey, respond just as well with food as they would do without. So I say to people, try and take your medications on time. Eat when you want to. If you're one of those people who notices a significant impact of protein, then we can have a conversation about how we divorce the medication from the mealtime. That happens relatively infrequently. And it happens typically when people have had Parkinson's for some time, and then it becomes more of an issue.
When you're exercising, do you need more levodopa? Do you use more dopamine?
Yes, you do. So I have patients who are keen cyclists, for example, who notice that they run out of steam if they're on a long cycle ride. And so there are ways of dealing with that by increasing your levodopa prior to exercise, having dispersible metoprolol. If you're on a long bike ride, for example, then perhaps having some more as top up. And you can work with your specialist to work out what works for you. Sometimes, you know, if you're very active and you feel that you're spending too much dopamine and you're running out, then often by just raising the background level of adding in medications can help. You have a certain amount of dopamine you can spend. When you've spent it, your body needs to recover and recuperate. So if you have a really busy day, it's not surprising the next day will be, you'll feel slightly more fatigued and whatever. So you can't perhaps maintain the intensity of activity that you used to.
So another question about levodopa, and many people use a controlled release levodopa to help them through the night. Why is it not more common to use controlled release levodopa during the daytime?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think generally controlled release isn't quite as controlled in its release as we would like it to be. So it becomes a little bit unpredictable if it's used when people are spending more of their dopamine during the day. When people are relatively inactive, it doesn't really have as much of an impact. We just need a bit of dopamine to keep the levels up, and that's better to be done at night.
What is Duodopa and how do I get some?
So Duodopa is levodopa carbidopa intestinal gel. And it's a medication which is levodopa with a dopa decarboxylase inhibitor, which is just like sort of madopar and cinema in a gel that infuses directly into the jejunum where it's absorbed. So you bypass the stomach And so you're able to give a slow infusion of exactly the amount of medication to minimize symptoms. Particularly, it's given in patients who are sort of further along the journey with Parkinson's, who typically are fluctuating between the on and the off state. And by giving this medication, it enables them to get better control of their symptoms. For example, people who have bad dyskinesia and then bad offs, because their therapeutic window used to be wide, it's now very narrow, enables you to keep within that therapeutic window, so minimize the off state. However, it's an invasive solution.
So you need a tube into your stomach, into your intestines, basically.
Yes. So it's like a feeding tube that people have, but it's with a medication being infused throughout the waking day, typically, although some people do have it over 24 hours. There's now a new medication called fos-levodopa, or pro-duodopa, and that is a subcutaneous infusion, which doesn't have those issues, and that's currently sort of being set up in terms of those medications being given to patients around the country.
A general question about dopaminergic drugs: do they become less effective over time? I mean, not just because the condition itself is getting worse, but because the drugs themselves, you become maybe more tolerant to them.
Yeah, you get that's a relatively contentious issue. I don't personally think that medication, you become immune to the medicines. I think it's just that the underlying neurodegenerative condition is marching on, and those medications just aren't quite able to keep up with that. But by fractionating medications, using medications together, we kind of get around that as much as we can. And we've talked about the advanced therapeutic options that are non-oral that can help with that if people aren't absorbing as well, and using different strategies to do that. So I don't think that people necessarily become immune from it. I think it's just the fact that we're dealing with an advancing neurological condition.
I get a dry mouth frequently. What can I do about that?
Yeah, so dry mouth is not an uncommon thing for patients, and it tends to be a medication-related thing, which is quite difficult to manage. So artificial salivas are available, so sprays to try to encourage sort of saliva. Sucking sweets can, and those kinds of things, sugar-free, can help to try to initiate saliva. Also useful if the other happens, and to help with swallowing.
So we're talking about the opposite problem now. So if I drool a lot, is there anything I can do about that from a medical perspective?
Yeah, so drooling, everybody produces about 1.5 litres of saliva a day.
Wow.
And with Parkinson's, you're just not swallowing as often, and it's coming out the path of least resistance, if you like. So often, drooling can be because worse in the off state. So the dopamine levels are dipping, and that leads to drooling. So often that can be a suggestion that the Parkinson's medications need to be optimized. Now, if that's still not creating the right sort of landscape to reduce drooling, then we can look at ways of managing that. Now, there are medical ways of doing that with things that dry the saliva up. There's a medication called glycopyrronium, which can dry the saliva up, but it has some side effects in some people. The other sort of more favoured option is to use Botox injections into the salivary glands, and that can then reduce the amount of saliva being produced. Works quite well for some people. It does need to be topped up every 3 or 4 months. Some people develop quite thick saliva when that happens, but there are some patients who really appreciate the effects of salivary Botox, and it really improves their quality of life.
So there's lots of information on the internet about Parkinson's. What do you think are some of the more reliable sources to go to?
So you're right. If you Google Parkinson's, you can be completely overwhelmed by the hits that you get. So I think it's much better to go to some very well-validated sources. So I normally direct my patients to Parkinson's UK, in the UK, and Cure Parkinson's Trust, Michael J. Fox Foundation, lived and I think that's important, because you need to have validation of what's been said. Reading things out of context can be quite challenging if you're not having somebody alongside you to interpret it, and it can lead to quite a lot of alarm. And actually, sometimes you just need that interpretation. Those sources that I've just said have, you know, they've a lot of work goes into the language. A lot of work goes into, you know, making sure that they're comprehensive, so that people can have a really good idea of, you know, and have an expectation that they're going to be reliable sources of information.
I only see my neurologist typically once a year. What can I do in the interim to find out more information about Parkinson's?
So the multidisciplinary team is available, and hopefully there's across the UK at least, there's access to Parkinson's nurse specialists, and they can be a good source of expertise in terms of managing everyday issues of Parkinson's disease. And I would encourage people to establish relationships with them and other members of the multidisciplinary team. So physios, the OTs, the pharmacists, the psychologists, there's lots of people there. Often people, different clinics run advice lines and that kind of thing. I know Parkinson's UK has an advice line, which is relatively generic, but it nevertheless can signpost people. There's lots of sort of literature available online that can sort of point people in the right direction. And obviously there are sort of general practitioners and people like that that can also help with managing symptoms and help with the liaison with the specialist out of your normal appointment time.
I've been diagnosed with Parkinson's. Should I get involved in clinical trials, and how do I get involved in clinical trials?
So clinical trials provide the opportunity to trial the sort of up and coming treatments. And these are widely available, and actually being a research participant enables other people, but enables you as well. You also probably have more contact with healthcare professionals through doing research. So actually sometimes people quite enjoy that bit of it, because they get sort of...
you get more scans and blood tests and all sorts of things.
And research isn't for everybody, and sometimes people can, it can create anxiety for some people, and there's no obligation for people to ever become involved in research if they don't want to. But I would, if you would like to, then there are lots of opportunities. And your local centre will normally be able to tell you which trials are being recruited to. Parkinson's UK and Cure Parkinson's will probably be able to signpost as well. I would encourage people to be involved with research.
Well, thank you very much for your time. That's been really helpful. Thank you very
much. It's a pleasure.